Okay. This is off to a straight start. That's great. Welcome, everyone. I always try to put something of great significance and helpfulness in every video. This one is going to be quite extraordinary, to say the very least. And if I say that, it's I mean it, you know. So you stay tuned to this if you can, because I have had quite an experience has taken place. Yesterday I had this experience at a golf course, which resulted in me flipping the script to an extreme extent and seeing the just a monumental understanding. And I explained that in a previous video, what happened. Now, maybe you don't know what happened, but I'm going to go over this again because more information has come to light. And it is quite extraordinary. I hadn't quite figured it out. Getting much closer now, and through extraordinary happenings. So, buckles, fasten your seatbelts. I was on the second tee of a golf course, and I saw someone walking up the sidewalk, which is right near the tee, and it seemed like a lady, an elderly lady, and she looked a little odd to me, out of place, like, so I kind of like sort of wanted to second take, kind of like, and I wanted to say hello to her. I said, "Who is?" I wanted, as a way of finding out, who is this? But I said, no, I got to go about my business on the tee here. And I took a practice swing, and I heard someone say, "Oh, my, oh, God." And it was someone who didn't speak English, really, okay, the way they responded. And I didn't know what to say. I said, what? Said, oh, my, oh, wow. Like some vast surprise. But there's something odd about it. I turned around and looked at it was a lady, and I said, "Okay, what's going on here?" I took another practice swing. I was hitting a 7-iron. I said, "I didn't warm up with the range or anything. I said, I got to take a practice swing and, you know, see how it feels." And this time, she burst out into peals of laughter. Now, this was extraordinary, and I explained to it in the other video, but it was so extraordinary. You never laugh at a golfer swinging. It was practice swing. She didn't know it was practice swing. She didn't know you're not supposed to laugh. She had no cultural understanding of what's going on at all. And this person looked very odd, to tell you the truth. But I kept my cool, and I asked the Holy Spirit what it means, and it eventually eventuated in this magnificent spiritual breakthrough. And then I began to realize that this was no ordinary person that was standing there watching me. This person stopped, still as a stone, and was just watching me on the tee. So I said, "Well, this is an appearance of a Dakini." And in answer to my prayers to the queen of all Dakinis, and unto my Ma, the appearance of a Dakini has happened. I made a prayer to all my teachers that some appearance happened this very day. And I realized this was no ordinary person that had appeared. And this was, and another thing I didn't say, but this was an old lady, an elderly lady who was shuffling along the sidewalk. Her laughter was that of a young woman. Peals of laughter, like a young, fresh woman. So that right there, you know, it registered, but I didn't pick up on it because of the whole thing, but in hindsight, I said, "Wait a minute, that was not a laughter of an old, elderly, shuffling woman who's reaching the, you know, the older years. Now, her appearance, I talked about how she had this hat, the way she's wearing her hat, and had some sunglasses on, and this coat, the way she's wearing. I said, this is not normal dress. The way she's dressed is not culturally normal. Nothing about her was culturally normal, actually. Especially her laugh, her behavior, everything. What was surreal. So, today, the next day, I couldn't sleep last night. I was just my mind, zhoo, 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 zhoo. Wow, what's going on? So today, I look up on Google, Queen of the Dakinis, which I call Ananda Maya Ma. She's truly the queen of all Dakinis. Queen of, but that's just one appellation, actually. It's just divine grace. If you could call a female appearance for, we call Queen of the Dakinis. I've Googled it, and this picture came up. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. And they said on the caption, Queen of the Dakinis. And immediately I was struck. I said, holy cow, that's the person that appeared to me, that appeared on the sidewalk. That's the guise she was wearing. So this is what is happening now. All right, there's more to it here, so tighten your seatbelts. Now, this personage called Queen of the Dakinis passed away in 2013, I believe. Maybe 2013. A couple years ago, passed away several years ago. Elderly lady. She was born in 1929. So 30, 70, 86, 87, minus 2, 80. So she was 85, 84, 85 when she passed away. 45, something like that. Maybe even 86. Not quite that. 84. Okay. So elderly. This person had the title Queen of the Dakinis and given to her why by the Tibetans, because she was a Tibetan woman. Revered in Tibet, they say she's the greatest woman spiritual master of the 20th century. Well, in their tradition, this is how they view her. Now, I looked at her picture and I said, oh my gosh, and she has a number of pictures. I said, this is the closest of anyone, any female I've ever seen that looks like Ananda Maya Ma. I've never seen her before. I've never seen this picture. I have no knowledge of this person whatsoever. I said, holy cow, this is a very profound spiritual being here. There's no question about it. And the Tibetans view her with extreme veneration. Viewed her. But she showed up yesterday. Here. She showed up yesterday, as live as can be. Now, how is this possible? Well, she was the spiritual consort of one of the greatest masters in Tibetan history, who also lived in the 20th century, who was a reincarnation, an emanation of Vimalamitra, who was the great Indian sage, Buddhist sage, who brought Dzogchen, the old teachings, Nyingma teachings, the original teachings to Tibet. Now, it gets even more amazing. Longchenpa, one of my great teachers, was reincarnation emanation of Vimalamitra, one of the greatest sages in history. This is someone who brought Tibetan Buddhism to Tibet, Dzogchen Buddhism, so to speak, to Tibet. So Longchenpo was the fullness of Vimalamitra with some other attributes added too. Okay. Now, this woman who apparently appeared to me, okay, yesterday, which was the 24th of February, 2016, was the spiritual consort of this great spiritual master that the Tibetans say was an emanation of Vimalamitra, which is saying this is the spiritual family of Longchenpa. Now, I don't know the spiritual teacher either, but in looking at him, I can tell this is a great master. There's no question about it. Wow. And this woman was his spiritual consort. Apparently, he was going to die, and Vimalamitra, the divine emanation of Vimalamitra, told him, take a female spiritual consort as a wife, and you will live longer. And that's what he did. And she was in devotion to the spiritual master. And after he passed away, she remained in devotion to him for a long, long time. So this is a Dakini, a very high Dakini, a spiritual consort of Vimalamitra that apparently appeared to me yesterday. Sent by Vimalamitra, sent by Anandamaya Ma, sent by Longchenpa, sent by what, you know? Someone, some spiritual grace sent this Dakini to me to trigger a profound realization. Now, I had not seen this person before, and I'm Googling it. As soon as I saw her, I said, oh my gosh. There's so much, so very much similarity to what I saw walking down the sidewalk toward me. And an elderly person like that, laughing like an ageless, you know, young woman, ageless. And I said, hey, wait a minute. Everything about it was surreal. So, one other thing. Well, okay. I was at a store today, and I had to buy something, and they were lacking cashier, so the store manager, very nice lady, was taking care of that, and I bought something. Then I went out, and I needed to fix something, and then I realized I need something else. I went back in, then I found something else was broken. I went back in again, third time. Every time I went in, I was looking for some other cashier. I didn't want to bother her. Four times I went back in, and every time, she ended up waiting on me. And her name was Sandra. They said, Sandra. Someone said her name. I didn't know her. I don't know her name, but she said that. She treated me with she's a very powerful kind of person. That she treated me very, very nicely. Very nicely indeed, John. But I felt, and she says, wow, again. Why are you coming back to see me? She said, Sandra. Okay. Their name sounds like that. I believe that's it is. Okay, so now, the name of this person I discovered, this great Dakini, female enlightened being, it's spelled K-H-A-N-D-R-O, Chandra, like, very much like Sandra. Could be, if it's an A, it would be Chandra. Chandra Tessering Children. Chandra Tessering Children. And the master that she was the spiritual consort of is Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro. Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro. These are bona fide spiritual emanations in the lineage of Longchenpa, actually. And they said that she, when she passed away, she had every sign of a fully realized Dzogchen master. Well, of course, spiritual masters don't actually pass away. This is just for show, for us. Now, when I saw this lady's face, I said, oh my gosh. And then I looked at her picture again, and suddenly I saw behind the mask, I saw behind her mask, and I saw this delightful laughing laughter. And she was looking at me saying, yeah. Peals of laughter I saw behind her face. That she knew that the body was just a mask, and that she was living in the spirit behind that mask. And the laughter, I could see the laughter in her. I could see her quality, and the laughter was exactly the same laughter that I experienced there on that golf course. Same laughter, bursts of laughter, and an oriental way of like trying to cover their mouth, like, oh, you know, like very Asiatic and everything. But it was amazing laughter. Amazing, you don't hear that laugh like, you don't hear laughter like that. Certainly nobody laughs like that at another person, you know, at their awkwardness. No one would do that. But a great Dakini would. A great spiritual master would. This epic spiritual breakthrough that continues, by the way. What I realize now that there's no such thing as merit. There's no reason to see bodies at all. We don't need to see bodies at all. We can see through the mask now. It's completely unnecessary to see bodies. It's unnecessary to see the world the way we've been used to seeing it. We can shift our perception because there's nothing to see. There's no merit. Merit, there's not even a trace of merit ever arising anywhere. How could merit arise in perfection? It's impossible. So a constellation of grace brought this about. Now, the pictures I have, this program here, it stretches all pictures to, the aspect ratio of this video. So the pictures are not set up to, I could, you know, they don't do her justice at all. You can look her up. K-H... A-N-D-R-O-T-S-E-R-I-N-G-C-H-O-D-R-O-N, Chandro Tessering Chodron. Let's see if we can take a look. The picture stretched, unfortunately. Whoops, that was a mistake. Let me see if I can take a look at this. There you go. Now, if you put sunglasses on her, which she often wore when she was older, that's it. That's it. Here's another picture. It's stretched even more. Slightly younger. That's it. That's the lady. That's the lady right there. Now this is stretched. It doesn't do her justice. It doesn't do her justice. For these spiritual masters, the body is just a mask. They're not the mask. They know they're not the mask. And the quality of laugh, you can tell something about the personal quality. This laugh, the quality of this laughter, the thing was, it wasn't quite an anamayama, but it was similar. It was more Asiatic laugh. It wasn't under my mind, more Hindi laugh, Bengali laugh. The same pealing, ringing quality to it. A transcendent laugh. If you've heard it, you won't mistake it. Of course, I'm very familiar with the laugh of Ananda Maimon. And this was very similar, actually, but not quite the same. That's why I threw me. I said, "Well, man, wait a minute. Something doesn't quite add up here." So, the great Dzogchen is making an appearance here in the West, like this. The great Dakini, as great Dzogchen Dakini, appears. Longchenpa helping out. He said he would help out. He didn't say how. We don't know how they help. And of course, all teachers are one. They're all one. It's all just one. Okay. But they have fun with it. You know, they're pragmatic. They enjoy it. I'm sure she enjoyed that. They could tell that she really was enjoying her role, playing her role there. Again, I'm struck, and looking at her pictures, I am struck that she is, actually, can I pull another, no, not really. She's as close to Nanamai Ma as I think as any woman I've seen. Her gaze, the composure, the appearance, the spiritual, you can feel it, the vibe, the spiritual vibe. She is indeed what you're talking about, of a high echelon here of spiritual emanation, high echelon spiritual emanation here. Now, we don't compare anyone with Anandamayi Ma. It says, leave me out of the comparisons. Okay. So that's fine. If someone wants to say she's the highest spiritual, female spiritual incarnation, fine. That's fine. Because Anandamayi Ma said, leave me out of this. Out of all comparisons. So, you know, as I said, it's getting interesting. And what's very interesting here is, Longchenpa has pledged to help us out. When I made a great appeal for help, he responded. I didn't know who he was, but this was the response I got. And he's clearly here. He clearly means business. This is the impression I have gotten. He clearly means business. This is not someone who's capricious, who messes around. This is someone who's all business. And this is a sign that he's working here. He's working on it. He means business. He sends a top Dakini like this. He has a very good relationship with the Dakinis. Tremendous, tremendous. Whatever that term Dakinis means, it's difficult to explain, okay? I've explained in the previous video how I see it. I'm not going to focus on that definition right now. He sent some top assistant. Colleague, you might say, colleague. Longchenpa again is absolutely tied into the Dakinis at the very, very highest level. Absolutely. and they will do whatever he asks them to do. There's no question about it. So here he sends a top dakini to appear here. And help trigger profound non-dual realization, a profound breakthrough in non-dual recognition, and help towards abidance, which is what he's helping me towards, is abidance. Now this lady, Chandra, Tessarine, this is someone, like, if I saw her, like, you know, sitting in a wheelchair or sitting anywhere, whatever, she's old, this is someone you would immediately recognize, and you would just sit down and be quiet. You would just, there's no doubt about it. The gaze is there, it is there. Quality is there. You just instant recognition. That's why she was wearing sunglasses. And I had this urge to greet her, and which I don't have. I've never had an urge to greet anybody walking along the sidewalk before like that. I had this urge to say, I was feeling so great. I said, hi, how are you doing today? You know, I wanted to greet her. She had these sunglasses. She had these sunglasses in there, like this disguise almost. And she, I got the feeling like, don't greet her. This is the intuition. Don't greet her. See what happens. This is the feeling. Don't greet her. See what happens. These are she and her spiritual master guru. These are a couple of heavyweights. There's no doubt about it. Wow. And I hadn't made their acquaintance before. It's a top echelon we're talking about here. And when you talk about the top echelon, you just let it be the top echelon, okay? You just let it be that. And there's a difference. There's a difference between the top echelon and those not quite in the top echelon. There's a difference. You can tell it. You can tell. The Tibetans know. You know, they know by and large who's in the, you know, top echelon. They're aware of that. These are a couple of top echelons, echeloners. I can feel the quality of her in me. I can feel it. I can feel it. And looking at her picture, I can feel it right away. Completely non-dual. Completely non-dual. Abidance. Absolutely an abidance. Non-dual abidance. Now, none of this bothers me because I'm totally ecumenical. But beyond ecumenical, it's non-dual. None of this matters. There's no such thing as merit at all. Nothing is happening. Nothing has ever happened here in this dream. It's all the same. It's all the same. These masks are not what we are. These facades are not what we are. So someone might say, how in the world would Longchenpa come to you and establish connection, contact with you, and I don't even didn't know who he was. And why would this great Dakini appear to me? You know, you're not a Tibetan, you're not Tibetan Buddhist, you're not this, you're not that, you're not that. None of that matters at all. It doesn't matter in the slightest bit, actually. Why would Ramana Maharshi make contact with me? I'm not a Hindu, you see. I don't identify like that way, but I don't identify necessarily in any way. It's not like that. I identify as we're walking together in the wow. All of us are walking together in the wow. I'm simply managing my success on the spiritual path, that's all. And spiritual success is the clarity that arises within us. Clarity doesn't know any denomination, actually. These fundamental recognitions that there are no obstacles at all. God doesn't have a single obstacle at all. These breakthroughs that see, wow, this is just clarity of the one mind. It's just clarity that arises. And then you have to manage the success of this clarity. This is what it's all about for everyone. So there is a universal religion, and it's managing our success. There's one problem, that's the continuity problem. It's the only problem there is. There's one practice, which is managing our success on the spiritual path. This is all important. And one key technique, which is full stop in the wow. This is how I'd say it. One problem, one path, and one technique. That's it. This is how I see it. It's that simple. Problem is the continuity problem. The path is the path of managing our success on the path. And the key technique is full stop in the wow. Now, coming across this, the pictures of this great Dakini, I'm telling you, it struck me. It struck me through and through. This is a very profound experience. It was completely unexpected. I Googled Queen of the Dakinis and this picture came out. I said, holy cow. Never seen this before. I've seen many, many, many female gurus, female teachers, etc. This one's a higher echelon. This one's in the top echelon. And she never taught. She never taught anything. No non-action. Just profound non-action. Let's say years of familiarity with the Nanda Maima. I think it was October 27th, I think, when I was really made her acquaintance in 1997. So, what is it? That's whatever that is. Have we completed 19 years? Is the 20th or one of the two? So, this is a lot, long time, massive amount of familiarity. So, coming across Chandra, Tessering, Well, I said, yeah, wow. Wow. So my reaction is, wow. Okay. But it doesn't, you know, throw me off or anything like that. It's, you know, I'm used to being in the presence. I've had many, many dreams of Anandamayi. So I'm used to that. So it doesn't throw me off at all. But it is a big wow. It is a big wow. That's for sure. Yeah. Wonder how I'll sleep tonight. That's right. Shit, I'll be fine. I'll be fine. So Longchenpa means business here. Great. All praise to the high echelon masters. He says, don't practice, don't practice, don't practice. I was reading from Spaciousness, the Radical Absorption of the Vajrayana, the Dhamma Dot, this, what the Dharma, from Keith, by Keith Dalvin, a nice, very good translation. Spaciousness, the Radical Absorption of the Vajrayana by Longchenpa. And in there, one of the cantos, you know, he's saying, don't try, don't try, don't practice, don't practice, don't meditate, don't meditate, you know, don't do. This is the essence of it. This is what he's trying to get to us. Drop all effort. Drop, don't analyze, don't analyze. Don't do that, don't do anything. You don't try to attain any merit whatsoever is what he's really getting at. Drop all attempts at merit, including trying to find merit in abidance, in no merit. There is no merit. There's not even a trace of it. You cannot find any faint trace of merit anywhere in reality. This is what he's getting at. Don't practice, don't practice, don't practice. This is resonating. His teachings resonate with me. Don't practice. And say, what is he talking about? And so here on the golf course, this great Dakini is burst out in laughter as I was practicing a golf swing, and it hit me later on. Don't practice. This is what she's getting at. Don't practice. I stopped practicing my golf swing. I just stepped up and hit it. And then it was flooded with this realization, spiritual realization. Don't practice. Practice is the attempt to gain merit. Our entire trouble is we're trying to gain merit, which is trying to say we're not, but we can add to what we are, that God did not create us perfect enough, that we can increase our perfection, you see. So this is Longchenpa saying, drop all these efforts. Drop all these efforts. Drop all effort. Don't make effort. Don't make effort. And so this great Dakini was laughing at my practice, saying, giving me a transmission. I was asking for a fifth transmission. This was certainly, you could say, a fifth transmission. I've had four great boosts in my life. This was a fifth great boost, this great Dakini. Her laughter triggered this great complex to become to surface, and I allowed it to surface, and I suddenly realized, wow, she's saying, don't practice. What are you doing practicing? You don't need to practice. I don't understand practice at all. Your practicing is missing it. You know, both practice swings I got, she reacted like, oh, you really missed it. And the second time I did it, she, oh, you missed it again. This is just too much. This is incredible. I was just like, she burst out and like, this is just the funniest thing she's ever seen, most incredulous thing she's ever seen. You missed it again. Oh my gosh, how is that possible? So when we're practicing, we're missing it. We're missing our true nature. Our true nature doesn't need to practice at all. What does it need to practice? Does it need to practice being perfect? Does perfection need to practice perfection? So, I do need to practice full stop in the wow here, though. This is our one practice. It's the practice of letting go of practice. And there's, because of our continuity fear, there's a wow factor with this. And then so we have to manage our success by applying this one technique. We have one technique here. One technique, which is full stop in the wow. But I'm telling you, the quality of this great Dakini is quite extraordinarily wonderful. You feel the essence of the greatness of Tibetan Buddhism, really do. There's that radical Dzogchen realization, you feel it. It's a slightly different quality to it than Anandamayi-ma. Slightly different. It's the same realization, but there's a slightly different fragrance to it. Slightly different fragrance being expressed there. It's the same, and yet it's the way it comes through to us is slightly different also. If it's possible to speak like that. Because the associations we have in our mind are different. I can't even express the first time I saw Sri Sri Anandamayi-ma. I can't even express what I experienced. It just completely flipped the entire script of my being to the point where I was simply reduced to tears and I couldn't speak. It's like a massive earthquake happened in my psyche. All the buildings fell down. Stunned beyond anything I could ever have imagined having happened. So I cannot, you know, reconstitute that. So I cannot say this is different. But just the way that it's experienced is wonderful. There's this wonderful quality, fragrance to it. And it evokes, again, the lineage, the great lineage, radical Dzogchen lineage of Tibet. It evokes it. You get a feeling of what it's about. With Anandamayi-ma, you get more of the great Hindu religion and lineages and what that's all about. Although she completely transcends all traditions, really. As does this Chandru Tesserin. Chodron. This YouTube website, I put up a new banner up on it, and it's this icon that I came across. That it's an icon of Longchenpa, and I sort of vectorized it so it changed it a little bit, colorized it in various ways, but to me it's striking. It's a very striking representation, I feel, of the essence of radical Dzogchen realization. It's the best icon I've come across. It evokes, for me, it's evocative of this quiet, still sweetness of realization. Manjushri. This quality, and this Chandru has this quality. These pictures, again, I don't do it justice. I could look up on the internet if I can get one. That's, if you want to just hang in here for for just a little while. We're just sort of hanging out here because this is something worth hanging out about, what has just happened. It's extraordinary, to say the least. Again, Longchenpa means business here, and that's a great thing for us. This is something to rejoice about. Now, I'm not inviting any, you know, Tibetan Buddhists to show up and say, oh, wow, this and this, this and that. I'm not going to say where it happened exactly or anything like that. No, this is not where I'm coming from at all. I don't really resonate with the structuredness of any religion in particular, actually. I'm seeing if I can open the internet here. Right now it's not opening yet, but it might. I'm trying to see if I can get a picture that is formatted in the right context for this video. Maybe we'll get it, maybe we won't. Again, you can look it up if you so desire. If you don't want to desire, that's fine also. There's no mandate to do that whatsoever. It's Google's not opening. That's okay. Tibetan Buddhism, of course, is just a history of the miraculous, really. I mean, you talk about all the Terma treasures, and the way they talk about it, most people think that, oh, this is crazy. No, not so fast. Not so fast. Could very well have happened, much like it's been talked about. Okay, finally Google opened. It's very slow. Just hanging out. This is worth hanging out with this. Not running off from this. Is Longchenpa means business here. Again, that is great news for us. This is not someone to be underestimated. These Tibetans, these great Tibetan masters, they mean business, and they're capable of conducting their spiritual business. We don't have any idea, really. I have some, capacity to go with the flow of it all. But these are enlightened beings we're talking about here. Can I get this web page to jump up? So we'll jump up. Loading. Okay. Well, there you go. See if I can find an image for us. Maybe not. Maybe it won't happen. Maybe it will. It's okay. This great Dakini is somebody who stops you in your tracks. There's nothing feminine about her whatsoever. It's just non-dual. It's just non-dual. Google images. Khandroteering, something like that. Is it picking this up? It's going real slow because I have this other program open. It's So I'm just sharing this here with you loyal viewers here, okay? So if you're meant to pick up on this, you're meant to pick up on it. I'm not going around telling people, other than just right here, Chandra, come on, Google, this is so slow, is it? T-S-E, okay, T-S-E. Chandra testering children. Images. I could get one that is formatted properly, that has the right look to it, but you know, stuff, sometimes stuff escapes us. $320 by $180. No. Well, no. Nothing exactly. It's all kind of small. Here's one that might do it. On Pinterest, I wonder. Let me. I believe this is her here. This is the. Yeah. I mean, we're talking about what the Tibetans call a great Dakini, and you have to give them the benefit of the doubt on this. You have to understand that they're, you know, they know what they're talking about here. Here's another one that might show up okay. So we have a few here, okay, so just bear with me here. Let's just have some fun with this. I remember, enjoy the spiritual path, enjoy it. And this is something very enjoyable we're doing right here now. Oh, I can't, no, that's wrong, do that. Okay. Okay, open up here. Very good. See if I can get this to, yeah. Okay, I'm looking at the computer, that's why I'm staring at this. Have fun with the spiritual path, have fun with it. Let's see if this picture will show up. I did somewhere, okay, good. All right, so making some progress here. Just practice full stop in the wow. Don't be in too much of a hurry. This is her spiritual master. This is this great spiritual master that she was a spiritual consort of this Jamyang Kiensei Choki Lodro. I'll put that up there too. So, this is a reincarnation, an emanation of Bimalamitra, one of the all-time great heavyweights in history, to say the least. All right. Well, we got it. We got. Let's see if I can get one more somehow. What do we have here? This one's not quite right. There was one. I know I'm just babbling on here a little bit. That's okay. This is, it's worth babbling sometimes. Okay. Come on, where was that picture? That's a small one. Oh my gosh. I'm having trouble locating it. Okay, here we go. This is, no, that's a thumbnail. I don't want to do that. What am I thinking? Lost it again. Okay, open it up. Bring it over here. So there's another one. Already a file with the same location. Images, cancel. Let's see. Okay. All right. So let's see what we have here. This is good enough. This is good enough for now. Unless I can find something that's. Don't name the thing images. Okay. Let me try this one. This is an older. When she's older. Let's see if this goes in here. Okay. Very great. Now I'm going to add these pictures. To the video. Somehow. Okay, let us try this. If I can. It's not behaving well at all right now. Okay. This is okay. All right, we got something. We have something. Let's try this. Shoot. Okay, let's try this again. Stay with it here. Okay, very great. We have managed to do something here. Let us go to an older picture of her here that this may be formatted better for us. I'm not sure. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. So there you get it. It's not stretched out or distorted. You get a picture of her in her older age. You see that hat, the coat, the way she looks like that. You can get the feel of it right there. I'm seeing it partially. Okay, yeah. Here is a picture of her when she was young. This one might. There you go. I can feel the non-dual composure there. Very, very strong. There she is, towards the end of her life. This is a small one on Pinterest. I will see if I can put this up here. It's going to be a little. Let me put this up here also. Okay, let's see if we can get this picture here for you. Yes, okay, there you go. You can just look at that and I'm gonna keep on looking through here, see if I can find anything. Oh, here's one. This one may be stretched a little bit. Let's put it in here anyway. Give you just sort of a taste of this. This is not an ordinary person, okay? Behind this mask is a non-dual abidance of the self. You can see it. You can feel it. See if I can keep pulling these up for you. Yes. Wow. Very profound. Very, very, very profound here. Okay. Maybe even too much wow for right now. It's bordering on that, you know. It really is. Why did it go here? I didn't switch it over to here. What is this? This is hilarious. It's shouldn't be on me at all right now. Why did this happen? Maybe it's too much wow. The program is still in picture mode. This never happened before. Maybe it's too much wow. This is what I'm thinking. It won't go. Let us see what happens here. It's extraordinary. It shifted back over to picture mode, but no picture is appearing at all. It just suddenly, when I felt the end, I felt this, that it's like too much, it's overpowering. As soon as I felt that, suddenly the program shifted out of picture mode and showed me instead of this great Dakini. Even though the program is still showing it's in picture mode. And now it seems to have frozen up altogether. To protect us, you know, so we don't get overloaded with this. Okay. What's going on? This is extraordinary. Too much wow. It won't show pictures anymore. Yeah. Wow. trying to get it to go back to pictures, it won't do it. Too much. Wow, isn't that amazing? Holy cow. At the instant I was aware that I had a reaction, this is too much, I can't take any more of this, suddenly the program shifted back to me and off these pictures, and I can't get it to go back. Wow. Just one moment. I'll try again. We'll see. No. It won't do it. It won't do it. This is too much. This is really something. It will not do it. It is absolutely will not go back into picture mode. So we've seen all that we're going to see of Chandra, Tessering, the queen of the Dakinis in Tibetan Buddhism, an emanation of Buddhist Tara. They say Tara. This is an emanation of high emanation. So this is a very cool, very nice introduction to the business end of Longchenpa. Business end of non-dual abidance, which is what Radical Dzogchen is pointing towards. It's not pointing towards the words or itself or anything else or the tradition or anything. It's pointing to non-dual abidance, where we're not seeking even a trace of merit. All seeking is seeking for merit. When we realize there's no such thing as merit, there can't be, then that's when seeking ends. That's when abidance is accepted. Now, the way to take all this is in the wow. Okay, this is the path. You must walk in the wow. And you know if you're walking in the wow, because you feel the resonance of it deep within, tremendous spiritual resonance. And that's the experience that you're experiencing. You don't go analytical on it. It's not, you don't go academic. You don't go left brain, you know, quantifying, measuring, that sort of stuff. No, you don't go into question mode. You know, you don't go into struggle mode. You don't keep going to concretization, reification mode, concatenation mode, none of that. It's just simple. No definition, no words, just wow. This is walking together in the wow. This is the path. And so oftentimes you're just quiet. Oftentimes you're just quiet. As you feel the wow, it builds up. It's just like, wow. So I have long practice with this. When you come into contact with these great, the upper echelon emanations here of grace, God's grace, this puts you into the wow. Course in Miracles always puts me in the wow, for sure. And onto my ma puts me in the wow. The wow is so strong I had to block it out. Like I had to, you know, put a hold on. I couldn't, I became so enthusiastic. You know, I tried to evangelize her, and that got me into trouble. Because you can't help but be just extraordinarily enthusiastic about it. But really, we just have to practice the wow. The wow might be a little too strong there. This great Dakini carries a very strong wow factor. There's no doubt about it. But very, very good practice, very good practice. So when we're quiet, we're feeling this just upheaval. A tremendous change in our destiny, our expectations, the destiny of expectations, a tremendous change. Suddenly our expectations for our destiny has become much brighter. Much, much brighter. And we have to accustom ourselves to the light, to this light of great expectations. The Tibetan Buddhists view Longchenpa as the fullness, the pinnacle of radical Dzogchen transmission that came through Vimalamitra and Padmasambhava, Sri Singha, and Garab Dorji, and Samantabhadra, Manjushri, these various emanations of God's grace, the pinnacle of this transmission, the apex was reached in the incarnation of Longchenpa. So we're talking about some very, very, someone who can take care of business. Let's just put it in a pragmatic way. Let's just put it that way. And certainly the Tibetan Buddhists have a history of taking care of business from a spiritual standpoint. They're world beaters. I don't know of any tradition that surpasses them in terms of taking care of business. I mean, they've gotten after it. They're all business. They just really is quite astonishing, actually. Now, for us, it's a little bit, it's something to get used to, because we, our tradition, our culture is that we cannot, lay claim to this kind of dedication. I can lay claim to working at it every single day of my life, very intensely. So there's something there, but they take it to a higher level of associating with all these masters and doing these intense practices and just absolute complete devotion, not just now, but for, bodhisattva vow. I mean, it's just, it is all in. They go all in. All chips on the table. So it's very humbling. It's kind of like they're like, going to golf analogy, like they're like pros, they're like Tiger Woods, and I'm like some, weekend hacker kind of, but who's able to handle himself pretty well out on the golf course. You might, you look at it that way, of he's able to get around. But they're like pros. So, there's something to assimilate, something to be aware of. Stay on your side of the fence in terms of your traditions, but certainly assimilate the dedication, the taking care of business aspect of it, the seriousness of it, assimilate that. This is interesting. It's getting real interesting here. My head, I hear hissing, because it's the intense upheaval here. This is very intense, but enjoyable. Love it. I love it. It's like standing next to Yosemite Falls or Prado del Falls. The intensity is, you could feel the was full waterfall. Wow, we did 1 year. It was like just full on. Full on, and it was just thunderous, and the mist was just everywhere, spreading through the forest. And that, getting close to that is really intense, and you're shaking, and it's just wow. But it's fun, it's enjoyable. It's very important to be able to sit quiet like this, committed to non-action, so you can allow this reverberation to happen and to let the wow calm down a little bit. You see the benefits of this. We spiritual, the grace of God and the Holy Spirit, they mean business. It means business, okay? As it emanates in many ways, echoing through the halls of this imaginary belief in time, imaginary effort towards merit. Holy Spirit means business. And the more we can tune into this and full stop in the wow, the more we become aware of its business, of it, business end of it all. It's not just theory, it's business. It's not just theory. It's pragmatic experiences also. So this is a whole different level of experiencing that I'm going through now. This is the appearance of someone that people claim is dead, appearing, plain as can be, interacting here. Okay, this is a different level. And you have to be able to handle that internally and not go ask the absurdist what it means. Or if it's okay, am I okay? You know, you go to the absurdist and say, am I okay? Could you, you know, send some doctors here to evaluate, am I okay? You don't do that. You see, the absurdists are absurdists. Absurdity is absurdity, okay? You just don't do that. So you have to be able to handle your business end of your path also. And take it in a positive way, not feel like threatened by it. They have their ways. They have their ways of taking. The Holy Spirit has its way of taking care of business. And it's beyond our science, so to speak. Science has to realize its limitations. I view myself as a great scientist, actually, because I've really looked at evidence to a profound extent. But I have to say, science has its limitations, and a true scientist knows the limitations of science. Okay, and there's a place where science stops and the Holy Spirit begins, so to speak. You know, science can only go so far. It has its place. Then you enter into the non-dual truth, reality. And science starts where reality begins, actually, in a lot of ways. There isn't really a science of reality. There's just an experiencing of reality. Because reality can't be defined as absolute freedom. So, very pleased to make your acquaintance, Queen of the Dakinis, at least in Tibetan Buddhism, Chandra Tessering, Chodron, Chandra. Very pleased to have been graced by your presence. Lovely laughter. Her cover was blown by her laughter. I mean, all her actions, in hindsight, added up to something. Some of my antenna was up, but her laughter really blew her cover, which she intended to, of course. That was the whole point. Don't don't practice. What are you doing practicing? You should know better. You don't need to practice. Just hit the ball. I turned around and said, see, I hit it, and she was gone. I saw she had already turned her back and was walking away. Message delivered. Just hit the ball. Don't need to practice. Just abide. Don't practice. Just abide. Don't practice. Just abide. Don't practice. Don't practice abiding. Just abide. Practice abiding. You're not abiding anymore. You're searching for merit. I think in Christianity we call the Dakinis angels. And usually they sort of have a lot of them have sort of a feminine, you know, we depict them as sort of feminine in a certain way, angels, oftentimes. Yeah, angels would be what Christians call, what Tibetans call Dakinis, angels. So this was an angel. In Christianity, would say it's an angel of the Lord sent to us. And angels are sent to us. Christianity has a great tradition of angels. Great tradition of angels. I've never been one to focus on angels, actually. I don't really know what's going on. We'll find out. So this was an appearance of an angel, actually. It was an angelic visitation just happened. But it was from a Tibetan angel, that had lived here in this world, actually. Now we'd say, well, angels, I don't know if Christianity has angels actually taking on a life here, I don't know. Not that I'm aware of, but the quality, angelic quality of the Dakinis, Tibetan Dakini, was present in this appearance here, this bodily appearance. This is what they say. I don't see any reason to say anything else. And the appearance after her death of her body like this, it's an angelic visitation here. Just happened. From a Christian's perspective, you would say that. Just had an angelic visitation. It's about time, you know, really, I mean, come on, let's get it going. I mean, we're slow pokes here, for sure. But we're getting back in the groove now, right? We're getting back in this groove. Let's speed things up here. Angels, angelic visitation, angel, let the angels appear. I've been praying for, let all bodhisattvas appear, make appearances now, miraculous appearances in the world. This has been my prayers. What happens? Angelic visitation happens. You could say bodhisattva, you could call her bodhisattva, dakini. There's various terminologies you could use. It's just the grace of God, no matter how you label it. It's like a pizza, it doesn't matter how you slice it, it's still a pizza. Still recording. Apparently, yes. We'll go back to a picture now. I can try. Oh no, I did effects. What am I thinking? Let's see. I won't do it. That's enough. It's so potent. That's enough. The Holy Spirit says, that's enough. You won't do it. That's just as well. It's, I've had enough. This is, you know, this is about all the well I can handle. I felt an overload. I felt it coming on. I reached, I maxed out as much as I could handle. So this is reverberating throughout me. It's a script changer, isn't it? It's definitely a script changer. We're entering into a new script here. With angels appearing, Dakinis appearing here in the world to trigger key insight, give us a massive boost. This is what we need. This is what we need. This is what I've been praying for. I said, you've got to do it. I was so insistent recently. I've been so insistent. So you got to take the next step. You got to do it. Time to take care of business here. And look what happens. Wow. God's listening. This is another part of the profundity of it. Yes. Like, oh, wow. So let's keep praying. Keep praying. This other woman that I went over the fence and she said, wait, I was looking at my golf ball this last week sometime and, wait, sir, wait, I have a question for you. And I jumped back over the fence and it was a black lady of color, you could say an Afro-American lady with tattoos and you'd see that somewhat disheveled, but who knows? Maybe this was very odd. The whole thing was odd, too. She goes, I want to ask you a question. I said, okay, could explain to me the difference between a birdie and an eagle. I said, well, a birdie is one under par, and an eagle is two under par. And explain you that whole, you know, there, if you make it three shots, that's one under par, that's a birdie. If you make it two, that's an eagle. And she goes, oh, thank you so much. You've really clarified it for me. Now I know. What to say, now I know. So it's like, that was like someone saying, I know you can explain this difference between abidance and duality, you know, oneness and two-ness. Please explain it to me. Oh, thank you, that was very clear. Now I understand it. Maybe that was an angel too. I don't know, the whole thing was very strange again. I don't know what they were doing, walking out in the middle of nowhere along the street like that. It was bizarre. And then insisted she ran after me. It's like, wow. So maybe, you know, just like some empowerment to say, you know, yeah, you can explain the difference. You're able to explain the difference here. You're able to give a clear explanation. Again, we're talking high echelon here. This is something that knocks us into silence. Different vibe. There's many teachers in the world, spiritual teachers. When you come across the high echelon ones, it's different. It knocks you into silence, really. It's profound. There's no thinking. You don't need to think about it. You know it. Right away, you know it. Just, wow. They don't have to put on a show at all. They don't have to say anything. You don't need to read a word they say. It doesn't make any difference. It's completely beyond words. You don't have to ask them for any instruction or practice or anything. It's an attention getter. It's a big time attention getter. What a contrast to the dance taking place in the world now. So many women in the world are trying to appear to ape, trying to be angelic, you know, angelic, trying to smile, and do I have the right makeup on? Do I have the right? They're actresses, you know. And when you see the real thing, you say, wow, what a difference. So obvious, isn't it? Very, very obvious. So many actresses in the world right now faking it, hoping to lead us down the road of absurdity. They seem to have no conscience. It's amazing. At least men seem to have some conscience about this. You know, that's shameful. I'm not going to do something like that. Some do, you know, and we men think, oh, shame on you. You know, don't fake it. Don't be a faker. But women just seem to have no shame whatsoever in trying to ape it, mimic it, act, put on an act. It's extraordinary. I mean, men and women have said, this is what came out in the 70s, I think. Women have been faking orgasms, faking sexual passions for eons, you know, the whole time. Men didn't even know it. Because to a man, it would, you know, you would never think about something like this, really. Just don't do that. But women, it's like, oh yeah sure, we can fake anything. We're expert fakers. And so they try to fake being angelic, trying to fake being enlightened. And, you know, they fool a lot of men. Just men just don't expect to be fooled in that way. A lot of stuff that men do, you can't give false information. You can't put on an act, you know. You can't act like you know something, you know, because a lot of the work men do is dangerous work. You can't just come on a job site and say, oh yeah, I know how to drive this, you know, I know how to operate this heavy machinery, and you have no idea how to do it, and you can't put on an act and pretend that you know how to do stuff, because you'll kill the workers if you do that. So there's a code. Men have a code. You do not put on airs that you know something that you don't. That is an absolute taboo. So much of men's work is teamwork in dangerous situations. And you got to know what the capabilities are of your teammates. and nobody can put on can be faking it. If you're caught faking, you know, you're out, you're on the outs. This is taboo. Which is why there's this hostility that men have, rightfully so, women invading their domain and putting on airs, and they don't like it, putting on airs. They said, this has got no place here in this business here. We got to know exactly what you know and what you don't know. And these little games that women play of like, well, I know so much, but you don't really know what I know, and maybe I'll tell you, maybe I won't. There's no place for that at all. Absolutely no place for that in a man's domain. You know, your life depends on your friends, your fellow workers, your companions, and of course the ultimate thing is war. You got to know who has your back and how much they have it and how trustworthy they are and just what do they know, what are they skilled in. You can't fake it. So men are very vulnerable to fakery from women under certain circumstances. They just can't believe that women will actually go there. They just can't believe it. And men just absolutely never crosses their mind to do such something like that. So you might say that the Dakinis help protect men from that female fakery, as to the great teachers too. It says, look, here's the real thing. Don't be fooled by these actresses. They're just in the service of absurdism. That's it. Yeah, I brought some stuff to the store, returned something, and the little receptionist there, a young woman, who has this attitude like, she's like, I'm like super great, you know, I'm like an angel, you know, this all-knowing angel, this is that attitude. Very, very nice, presentable, beautiful young woman, but you could tell, like, you know, aren't you impressed by me? And I brought a couple things back, and she looked at it and said, oh, were you supposed to bring this back? I don't know anything about this. And she's like, kind of like, you know, I mean, her cover was blown. She didn't really know what was going on. She acted like she was on mission, but then the easiest, slightest thing, she didn't know what was going on, really. And I said, you know, I thought you think it's okay, yeah, this is what's supposed to be. She goes, oh, okay, yeah. And then right back to like, yeah, I'm this wonderful omniscient angel. I said, wait a minute, no. Okay. But they're eager to see, how am I acting? Yeah, this is a quality you get from actresses. There's the subtle, always there. How well am I acting? They're looking at you in a dualistic way, like, am I getting over on you? How well are you convinced in my acting job? Whereas a true angel, a true Dakini, there's none of that. There's none of that. There's a different quality, you can feel it. They're legit. They're not acting at all. This is a different quality. There's no dualism there. They're just abiding. That's it. So you can tell the difference. And absurdity is trying to confound the difference. So you can't tell the difference, but you always can. You just have to be taught to distrust your intuition, which is what's happening in the world. Is supposedly men are being told that they can't trust their feelings, they can't trust their intuition, that women are the experts, they'll make the determination of what's real and what's not real. And we just have to take their word for it. Extraordinarily dangerous thing to do, given how great women are at acting and putting on and faking and you know, with shamelessly, with no conscience. You know, women's prerogative is to shamelessly deceive, really. And so the idea that we just have to take women's word for what's going on is disastrous, and not trust our own intuition. We absolutely, men absolutely can tell the difference. sample here, clearly. As soon as I saw her picture, I said, boom, immediately knew. This is the real thing. This is abidance here. And yet our culture is disallowing such recognition for men. It's enslavement. It's cut and dry. There's no feminine specialness to it. It's cut and dry. It's black and white. That's the, you know, to see the truth or absurdity. There's no wiggle room here for gender. There's no gender wiggle room at all in recognition. And this playing this card, this gender card, is completely dualistic and absurdist, actually, off track. You either see it or you don't. If you see it, you see it. If you don't, you don't. If you recognize it, you recognize it. If you don't, you don't. There's not some special recognition that women are somehow have. Your recognition isn't it. They're going to tell you about it. You have to accept it. No, there's none of that. You either see it or you don't. Either you recognize abidance or you don't. Either someone's abiding or they're not. Either there's abidance present or there's not. This is a spiritual recognition. It's not a gender-based recognition at all. So this shakes up the whole paradigm, modern paradigm, this angelic visitation, this Dakini appearing to me, and I'm speaking so adamantly about, you know, these gender issues, and that everything's out of whack in the most terrible way, actually, here. And yet this Dakini appears to a man, you know, an elderly white man, what? You know, this is not in the paradigm of the absurdists and the yoga girls. That's not in the yoga girls paradigm at all. That's not part of their script. In other words, it's not in their script at all. This Dakini is not a feminist. This is a non-dualist. There's no agenda there other than non-dual realization, abidance. That's it. So I'm just enjoying this massive earthquake. it's just okay, this is wonderful. Wow. Still going on. It's still going on. I'm just riding this wave. It's like surfing a giant wave. It's like I caught a huge wave and I'm just surfing it. It's quite a ride. Actually, last night I felt lightheaded. I really felt very lightheaded. Like I moved my head, like, wow, what's going on with me? And I couldn't sleep last night. I don't know if I'll sleep tonight. I did take a nap today, like an hour's nap, which helped me. So I'm able to nap through this. I mean, it's like riding a very big wave. I've ridden fairly large waves, what you would call a big wave, not the big, real big ones, literally surfing. you know, maybe a 10 to 12 foot. Maybe I rose a couple times. I've been out in some big surf that was pretty scary, say the least. But not the real big stuff. Not the 40 foot waves, 30 to 40, you know, whatever, 20, 30, 40 years. I'd get up those. Nah, had nothing like that. But this, you know, this is like riding a big wave, spiritual, riding a big spiritual wave. Really big. It's a different feeling, you know. When you experience this, your heart is pounding. I mean, you're in the wow. This is not really pounding, but I mean, your spiritual heart is pounding. I'm still physically I'm calm, but my spiritual heart is pounding. So it's like a big spiritual wave. It's just caught on, just caught a very big spiritual wave. I say it's time to start riding the big waves now. Mahalo and aloha, and we're riding the big waves right here. Big wave rider here. Now it's interesting. Did this happen or not? In terms of whether it was actually an angel visitation, how can you scientifically say one way or the other? But for me, spiritually, it happened. I mean, my reactions are such that it happened. This is what is key, because this then opens up the door to the miraculous. And I'm a huge believer of it. My whole life, I've been a huge believer in the miraculous. Never wavered from that. Jesus titled his latest work, A Course in Miracles. Please take notes. A Course in Miracles. He's here to open up the door to the miraculous. So we need to go through that door. So the other reverberations continue. Very, very powerful. The ramifications are just immeasurable, you know. So it's a feeling of immeasurableness. You can't put it in a box. You can't contain it. Just let it ring. Let the bell keep ringing. Don't even try to think too much about what does it mean. It opens the door. On the miraculous, you could say it opens the door on the miraculous. Clear-cut case of the miraculous interacting with us here and triggering a tremendous spiritual advance. So we're getting back to where we need to be. People back in the 60s, so we're getting back to the 60s, people are talking about miracles. They're talking about, wow, all these amazing synchronicities, amazing miracles. You know, we were open to it at that time. And then, you know, the corporate absurdity, this whole absurdist culture and belief system has tried to slam the door shut on all that. Anyone on YouTube that makes a mention of the miraculous, there's these materialists get real snarky replies. It's just a real nasty culture. Another miracle I can tell you, I put in the tape just previous to this one, taping today, audio tape, sitting outside, and this I saw this man walking with a pack, very interesting pack on his back. So this kind of foam that you use to sleep on. That was the outer shell of the pack, and there's something probably. But behind that, couldn't quite see. I'd never seen anything like that. He looked like sort of just a wanderer. And then another wanderer passed by. This one had a wooden staff and a sleeping bag rolled up, and the wooden staff going through the middle of the sleeping bag. The sleeping bag was like rolled up like a, it could roll it up so there's got a center to it that you can put something through the center of it. And he had a staff, a wooden, long wooden staff put through the center. Well, I was cleaning up my stuff yesterday, I think. And I suddenly came across this holy card of St. Jude. And I said, wow, I think I'm going to put this right here. This is important. Something about St. Jude is coming up right now. Patron saint of lost causes. We've made some big requests of St. Jude. I have in the past. Absolutely. I've leaned on St. Jude at times. A great Christian saint. Christians have many great saints. And so I put this card right next to my desk, leaning up there. Well, I looked over today at the card of St. Jude, and I was struck, very struck, because the wooden staff in this holy card of St. Jude was the same wooden staff that this person walking by, this wanderer, had stuck through his sleeping bag. This is a very interesting wanderer, because he was dressed very nicely. Dress shoes, nice pants, everything, and yet he had his backpack, sleeping bag, a wooden staff. I said, what is going on? This is very unusual. It's what in the world? I've never seen anybody carry a sleeping bag like that. Now, just after that, I didn't put this in the video. Just after that, I'm driving. I make a turn on the street, and there's traffic stopped, and I make to make a left turn. They're stopped, and somebody comes walking through the stopped traffic, and it's a homeless person. And they have some food. They got some food. But this person was disheveled. This person was very negative vibe. Like an evil vibe, actually. And so I made this turn. I saw him coming. And I said, my mind said, should I stop for him? Or should I go past him and then let him go? Because I had the right of way here. He was not like he was walking in front of my vehicle or anything. I saw him and I said, you know what? I'm going to drive past him. And he can go behind me. I'm going to sidestep this. I'm not going to stop and let him go in front of me. This is like a Charles Manson type of individual, actually. Not a good individual at all. This is somebody that meant trouble. His face, his beard, the way he looked, at least that is my impression. The shirt that he was wearing, this is some sort of bad news coming. I decide I'm going to go on ahead. The bad news is going to be behind me. Amazing. Because ordinarily I would have stopped. I almost stopped. Because I said, let's give this guy, come on, give him a break, go ahead. But he was glaring at me. So I raised a hand, I raised one finger like this to him. I raised a finger and said, you know, just, I'm going to go through. I pointed, I'm going through. I let him know. And he was looking at me. I didn't let him intimidate me. I didn't let him stop me. But he was a very intimidating look and presence about him. Demonic, actually. Yeah, I said, no, you're not stopping me. You are not stopping me. We will go to a reduced intensity zone, and then you can carry out your mayhem here as you're certainly planning. Now, one of the problems going to reduce intensity is so always, what do I do? What about my practices? What about all my efforts? What about my merits? You know, blah, 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 blah. Well, of course, there's no such thing as merit. We don't need any merit. We're already perfect. So that's a good thing. But we're worried about that, aren't we? Well, what about my resume? What about all, you know, people say, oh, he did this, he did, she did this, she did, you know, whatever. My merit, what about my merit? Oh, can I bring that with me? No, there's no merit. There's no merit required. This is the key to getting into a reduced intensity zone. Now, I don't know exactly what my background is. It's just that I know the previous life, one previous to this, but the other ones, I saw them all when I was 1978. I was about 22 years old. I saw all my previous lives, but I didn't identify exactly what they did. It happened quickly. I sort of did, but I didn't remember. I didn't exactly remember. So I don't know exactly where all my lives have taken place. I know there was an assortment of all sorts of different types of lives. Been a king or some, it's some one life, and then, you know, but some other stuff, it's just different, all different sorts of things. Studying, you know, just a cross section. So, but I'm not sure if I ever like had a life in Tibet, for instance. I don't know. I have an attraction to like Japan and the East. Maybe I had, you know, life in just Japanese life. Most likely, I feel comfortable around, you know, Japan, Japanese. I feel like I lived there. I've lived there before. Maybe I've had a Tibetan life. You know, it's quite possible. Indian life, you know, very possible. Lives in India. Jewish life, very possible. Certainly had European life, several maybe, and you know, that, so probably been around the block quite a few times. This is the 33rd life that I'm aware of. So, but lives in different places like this help one be ecumenical, and also ultimately help free one from merit any practice whatsoever. I'm not attracted to any particular practice at all. I'm attracted to this overall ecumenicalness that transcends all sectarianism and all paths and all of attainments, transcends that into what? No path, no attainment, no achievement, no merit, no practice. This is abidance. Abidance transcends any tradition or approach, really. And I would say I belong to everyone. I belong to everyone everywhere. They said, "Oh, you are special." She says, "Well, I belong to everyone." And they had a hard time with that, the difficulty. "No, no, no, you're our special Ma, you're our special this or this." And she would just be quiet. So, the Dandala Abidance transcends. It's the recognition that we're all perfect. We're all members of one spiritual family of perfect spirit. We've never incarnated, actually. None of us have ever incarnated, just a dream. We're not bodies, we're free, we're still exactly spirit, exactly as God created us to be. We don't need to put our attention on bodies at all. There's no such thing as merit. So what are bodies for? Don't have any value at all, actually, except to communicate this truth. Help communicate this truth as a sort of a fig symbol of a, you know, a dream figure. Okay, so gone over 2 hours, right? Wow. Time flies when you're in the wow, doesn't it? Okay, very great. Thank you all very much. And let's leave it at that.